Hello, everybody. I'm Kenneth Copeland. This is the Believer's Voice of Victory broadcast. I'm going to say it to you right now. Get the notes. KCM.org/notes. You really do want the notes in these broadcasts last week and this week because we're dealing with Jesus' hometown, his home there in Capernaum. And the more you see that, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John just, wow, he really is a man. He really lived. He had a house. Amen. Thank you, Father. This is a wonderful opportunity. We enjoy it and we love you and we thank you for revelation, for opening our hearts and minds. And we pray, Holy Spirit, Father, we thank you. And Holy Spirit, thank you for being our teacher. Thank you for just rising up in all of us and causing. Oh, excuse me. Oh, yes. These are the days when revelation is most important. It is absolutely necessary for you to know things at this day and hour that those before you, it was wonderful for them to know them, but you are this generation that really needs it because I, saith the Lord Jesus Christ, I am more excited about this than you are. I am so excited that we're coming up into the end days. Glory to our Father, because I'm looking so forward to having you home with me. And if you will allow me, if you will work with me, and if you will begin to look into my word and allow your faith to become strong, and get built up in my word, I'll manifest myself to you. I'm already there. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. And I want you to know I'm there first thing in the morning. I'm there last thing at night. And whatever happens, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I love you more than you can imagine. And if you'll rest in me, you'll see mighty, wonderful works happening in the land of the living, saith the Lord. Whoa! Hallelujah! Whoa, I wasn't expecting that this morning. Well, I was expecting it, but I'm always expecting it. But, oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, what a way to live. Glory to God. Now, yesterday we were talking about the man born of four men, but we didn't get finished. So let's start that over again at Matthew 9:1. He entered into a ship and passed over and came into his own city again, which is Capernaum. And behold, they brought to him a man sick of the palsy, lying on a bed, Jesus seeing their faith. Now see, you can see faith. You can see it in action. It was in action. Come on, who wants to be carried up on top of somebody's house and you're sick of the palsy? But hey, man, I mean, can't you just see them? They said, come on, Charlie. We can't get in the house. It's too full. Let's get up there on the roof. What? You gonna take me up on? No. He saw their faith. Said unto the sick of the palsy. Now, make some notes here because there are things that are very important in each one of these accounts that one said that the other didn't. Notice this. Son, be of good cheer. Cheer up. Can't you see Jesus? Standing there in his own house. And he hears the slate sliding off the roof. And he gets this big grin on his face. And he's watching them come down. And he didn't wait till he got down on the floor. No, he said, son, cheer up. Your sins are forgiven you. That was big in that man's mind. One of the things probably, well, you can assuredly say it was one of the things that was holding him back. It's sickness and disease doesn't bring out the best of people. It brings out the worst in people. All right, let's then. And behold, certain of the scribes said within themselves, "This man blasphemeth." Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, "Wherefore think you evil in your heart? For whether is easier to say, 'Thy sins be forgiven thee,' or to say, 'Arise and walk'? But that you may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins," then saith he to the sick of the palsy. You see the connection there? "Then saith he to the sick of the palsy, 'Arise, take up your bed into thine own house.' He arose, departed to his house, but when the multitude saw it, they marveled and glorified God, which had given such power unto men." Now, here's what I wanted you to see here. This was not a hostile group. They didn't come there to fuss with him. You know, I always thought, I just really didn't pay much attention to it till I realized, hey, they're in Jesus' house. They're there on purpose. They came to hear him. They just got their religion sidetracked, their thinking. But he straightened that out and they marvel at it. All right, let's go to Mark 1. And let's look at the, Mark 2, excuse me, first verse. "And again, he entered into Capernaum after some days." So after some days, what's he been? He's been on the road. Some days. He went on. "And it was noised that he was in the house." He's at home. "And straightway many gathered together insomuch there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as at the door. And he preached the word unto him." His own house now. Now, see, this is the other one, "Son, be of good cheer." This one says, "He preached the word to them." Very important. Make notes of that. "They come unto him, bringing one sick of the palsy, which was born of four. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed where the sick of the palsy lay. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the sick of the palsy," now we know he said, "Cheer up." Mark records, "Son, thy sins be forgiven thee." But we know he said, "Cheer up." Okay, that's important. He preached the word. He said, "Cheer up, thy sins be forgiven thee." But there were certain of the scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, "Why did this man speak blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God only?" Immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they so reasoned within themselves, he said unto them, "Why reason ye these things in your hearts? Whether is it easier to say to the sick of the palsy, 'Thy sins be forgiven thee,' or to say, 'Rise and take up your bed and walk'? That you may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins." He saith to the sick of the palsy, "I say unto thee, arise, take up your bed, and go thy way into thy house." And immediately, that quick, he arose, took up the bed, went forth before them all, insomuch they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We never saw it on this fashion." I don't have time to go with what I just saw there. Maybe we get it later. Now, Luke chapter 5. And 17th verse. Now we found out, he said, "Son," he said, "Cheer up, thy sins be forgiven thee." And he did what? Huh? What did he say? No, he preached the word unto them, right? So we're gathering something out of each one of these. We're in, what did I say, 7:1. Luke 7. Luke 5:17. Thank you for helping me. It came to pass on a certain day as he was teaching, there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which were come out of every town of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem. Now here's another. And the power of the Lord was present to heal them. Okay. The power of the Lord was present to heal them. Of course, Jesus was there. He preached the word to them so they could have had faith to receive it. But they got, the devil sidetracked them just enough. I've had the devil do me like that. He gets some sidetracked on some little issue, and Brother Hagin be preaching there and preaching there and preaching there, and I miss 4 or 5 minutes of what he said. What did he say? You know, you're sitting there thinking, boy, you're right, you know, you're just going along, and all of a sudden you think, I wonder why Brother Copeland wears so many blue suits. You know, I wore a black one today. That's kind of unusual, isn't it? Now, you guys have been a lot of meetings about it. It's unusual for me to wear anything but blue. Gloria likes blue. I like blue. God likes blue. You got a whole sky full of it. So, and hey, go check out the color of the priest's robe. Anyway, that's just an excuse. Let's see. I just wonder how come Brother Copeland wears so many blue suits and miss it. How something happened in the room got your attention and you miss it. A lot of times it's about to be something you really needed to hear, and the devil's doing anything he can to keep you from hearing it. Distraction in the place. I learned as an athlete many years ago, my mother's brother, my uncle, And he was, what a, I mean, this man was just a marvelous football player. He knew the game. And he taught me how to kick extra points. And he said, now, Kenna, you get your eye on that ball. Don't you take your eye off. This goes eye-hand coordination. It happens in golf, and everybody that knows this, but he said, you focus. I learned how to not take my eye off that ball until after my foot had already gone through it. And in high school, I only missed, I think, we had a winning team. I mean, we won a lot of games. And if I remember right, I didn't miss but 3. Maybe 4, something like that. But it wasn't because I was so good at it. It's because I knew how to concentrate on that ball. And he told me, he said, the crowd will tell you whether you made it or not. Well, I took that then, and knowing that, my dad had taught me that and teaching me how to pitch, keep my eye on it, da-da-da. Well, when I went to Oral Roberts University, I mean, I knew what I had to do. I had to focus in on him. I'm telling you, you could have fired a shotgun. I wouldn't have known it. I was so locked in on him. And then I'd go to Brother Hagin's seminars after we got out of ORU. I was so locked in on him to hear every word he preached, to lock in on it. We're just totally immersion in it. And my spirit just grew. I mean, here I was a scripturally literate when I went to Oral Roberts University. And before I left, I was going to a meeting, I was part of the flight crew, and I had professors looking me up in the study hall, Brother Kenneth, would you pray about this? It got out that my faith worked. There were guys that had been in the ministry more longer than I was old. I wasn't but 30. That's old for a freshman, but hey. Why? My faith grew exceedingly. Why? Hey. The Word. But you have to be so concentrated on it that, see, they lost it because they got their minds on who could forgive sins. So the power was there. All they needed was faith to connect with it. Now, wait a minute. The power of the Lord was present to heal. Behold, men brought in a bed and so forth. And verse 19, when they could not find him, they took him up before Jesus. When he saw their faith, he said unto him, Man, thy sins be forgiven thee. And the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason. See, they were reasoning, saying, Who is this which speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? But when Jesus perceived the thoughts, he answering said unto them, Why reason ye in your heart? Which is easier to say, Thy sins be forgiven thee, or rise up and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man hath power upon earth to forgive sins, he said unto the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, arise, take up your couch, and go to your house. Immediately he rose before them, took up that wherein he lay, and departed in his own house, glorifying God. And they were all amazed, and they glorified God, and were filled with fear, saying, We have seen strange things today. Now, we said this yesterday. The same power, same, no difference. The same power, the same anointing that heals, forgives. It's not two different anointings. It's the same thing. Now, this is the reason why it is so important to do what Jesus said in Mark 11, 23, 24, and 25. When you stand praying, forgive if you have aught against any. It don't make any difference whether you feel like forgiving or not. Amen. It's not a matter of your feelings. If you follow your feeling, you whipped already, because your feelings are always behind everything. Did you know that? Did you ever realize the fact that if God met people's needs because they had needs, that He'd just be following the devil. That's the reason it takes faith to connect with it. Amen. So it's so vitally important. If the power was there to heal them all, we found that out. But without faith, there's no connection. Amen. And they came there to hear Him. They weren't antagonistic toward it, because they were all thrilled when this guy got up and walked home. But they still didn't get it, because they didn't hear what He was saying. While He's preaching the Word, they're sitting there thinking religious thoughts and missed it. Amen. All right. Now then, I want to go to the 13th chapter of the book of Luke. Luke chapter 13. Yeah, thank you, Lord. I'm not done with that other. Let's talk about faith for a moment. Hold your place there and go back to Mark 5. We talked about this to some degree last week, but let's go here. I want to look at the woman with the issue of blood. Now, we're going to be looking at two things here, faith and power. Say, faith and power. A certain woman which had an issue of blood 12 years, suffered many things, many physicians, and spent all that she had, and was nothing bettered, but rather grew worse, when she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched His garment. For she said, now that's her faith speaking, if I may touch but His clothes, I shall be whole. She didn't say, I might be, well, I want it. No, she said, I will. I shall be. And straightway the fountain of her blood dried up. So she got what she believed and what she said. And she felt in her body that she's healed of that plague. Jesus, immediately knowing in Himself that virtue or a power had gone out of him, turned him about in the press, and said, Who touched my clothes? His disciples said unto him, Thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, Who touched me? And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, Daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. Faith and power. She put a demand, a faith demand on his anointing. He certainly didn't do it. He's following Jairus. Jairus' faith put him on the move towards his house, and the woman stopped him in the middle of the street by faith. Amen. Jesus didn't do it. The woman did it. She stopped him. Now notice it. She was aware. She felt it in her body. The blood stopped. She was aware of the power going in. And Jesus was aware of the power going out. Faith. Say faith.
Faith.
That's the reason faith is the major connection here. That's what those scribes and doctors and so forth, that's what they missed. They could have done the same thing because the power was there to heal them. Did you get anything out of this today? We'll be back in just a moment.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching from Kenneth Copeland Ministries. And remember, Jesus is Lord.